Hello and welcome to the Mutual Fund Show. My name is Neeraj Shah. Over the next 30 minutes, in fact, over the next two episodes, we are going to be talking about how to plan for your retirement using mutual funds. Now, just for giving a bit of a view into how will we do this, or the first show, which is today's show, we are going to be talking about how anybody who is not yet retired can plan for their golden years through the earning years, which is, let's say, for argument's sake, starting from the age of 30 or 25, whenever you start earning, in some cases even 20, all the way up till the retirement age, which is whatever, but for argument's sake, 60. And then in the next show, we'll try and talk about what are the best options for somebody who's already retired and wants to make sure that his or her golden years go through comfortably. And to talk about that are two eminent experts. Independent financial planner Gaurav Mashrola, also author of a book on personal finance meant exclusively for retired people, and then author and mutual fund expert Amit Trivedi. Both of them join us on the show. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining in, and thanks so much for being a part of the show, because we've got a lot of demand from people saying that how do we plan for retirement. Now, obviously, there is a lot of personal finance angle attached to it as well. Sure. But as we had discussed, that mutual funds could go a long way in trying to do this. Now, let's start off. This is the first show where we're talking about what do people who are currently earning, whether they've started earning or in different phases of the time, we'll go through that, can do for those years of their retired life. How do mutual funds help in that process?
So first is Neeraj, mutual fund, lot many times people feel as an asset class or instrument. No, look at your life stage, whether you are in 20s or 30s or 40s or 50s, and then try and find out where would this instrument fit. Because this instrument is such a versatile instrument that we can fit for various needs. Now, somebody who's just started, 20s or 30s or whatever, by simply starting a small SIP into a mutual fund and mentally saying this is for my retirement, that itself will help him immensely. It's a question of developing habit. So even if that person starts with small amount of 500 or 1,000, over 25, 30 years, and in those years, when you are starting your career, you may not have a lot of other goals, so you can go a little aggressive. You also have, during the entire working life, the ability to maneuver. So if newer products come in, you can take more risk, and you are giving your money more time to grow, as in nurturing and then growing. So this is a brilliant instrument to accumulate money for your retirement.
The only place where I would debate that is that I remember that when I started earning, even though I didn't have too many goals, the money that used to come at the end of the month was never enough to fulfill the next month's whatever limited goals that I had as well. So that's the question, right? I mean, maybe you start less and then expand. And we'll get to this as well as to why is it that mutual funds are preferable over others. But Amit, you just want to come in on this, that how do mutual funds per se help? Because traditionally, when people talk about mutual funds, that's for wealth generation and not necessarily retirement goal planning, because for that people use a lot of other instruments, insurance policies, so on and so forth.
Sure.
Why mutual funds?
So first of all, most of the traditional approaches towards retirement planning, they involve debt instruments.
Yes.
Yeah? So whether it is PF, PPF, or many of the insurance policies, etc., where the return on investment may be lower, though the product could be safer. Whereas because there is a long period, and if you are able to earn something more, the power of compounding would work wonders, especially for a 20, 25, 30 year period. And that's where the equity options within mutual funds, so equity mutual funds, can be used. Secondly, people who are working somewhere, they have a PF deduction, which is equivalent to doing an SIP in a debt product.
Yes.
Yeah, so even in order to balance that, there could be an SIP in an equity mutual fund. Thirdly, you can also look at doing some amount of SIP in a debt mutual fund, even for a long horizon, just in case you want to shift from debt to equity periodically or equity to debt periodically. PF, LIC policies, etc. do not allow any withdrawal. Whereas here, that rebalancing becomes possible.
Okay.
So mutual funds, apart from what Gaurav mentioned, multiple options, there are multiple flexibilities also.
Yeah, in fact, that's a point that I think Gaurav was making on the call with me earlier as well, that one of the things that people overlook about mutual funds when it comes to retirement planning is how flexible it is to have these instruments over a longer period of time compared to maybe other annuity products. We are not decrying that the other products are good, but we are highlighting the benefits of mutual funds. Would you want to talk about
that? Yeah, I won't talk about it, because what happens is typically once I choose a particular product which is not mutual fund, I'm stuck to the underlying asset. Now, I may not want that. I may want an option to maneuver across various asset classes. So today, let's look at, we have mutual funds in debt, we have in gold, we have in equity. Over a period of time, we may even have mutual, and we do have it currently, mutual fund invests in international market, and we may have some other things coming up. Now, that ability to change from one to another, maneuverability, is only in mutual funds. Now, just because it does not say retirement or for pension, does not mean it can't be used. Second is, if my particular fund is not performing, I am at very much ease just to either take out money or not give it more money. Somewhere else, I may be just stuck as to, just because I've opened a particular account or I have had some kind of scheme, I have to contribute, whether I like it, I don't like it. Thirdly, what happens if I have more money coming in? I want to contribute more.
Yeah.
This year has been good for me, either I got a bonus or a couple of my expenses were not there or whatever it is, and I want to contribute more. Mutual fund gives me all these options. So across on different asset classes, across different regions, across different fund houses, and the amount that I can do it.
Yeah, so multiple flexibility options available over a 20-30 year period. I mean,
exactly.
Let's assume, viewers, I think what we're trying to say out here, what the guests are trying to say here, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is that if you are at 25 or 30 and you are investing for the next 30 years, you do not know what changes will happen over the next 10 years to your income, as well as the rules and regulations that govern, or the options that come up. And while investing through mutual fund route for your retirement, you'll be able to make alterations to your investment plan in a much more easier fashion compared to some of the other options. Is that a good summation?
Yeah, and just to add to that, another angle, that flexibility. So look at mutual fund as something which is absolutely transparent. So you get timely, relevant information and timely. Yeah, and you are also able to act on that information because of the liquidity. Now, that combination of transparency and liquidity provides that extra degree of safety, because there have been instances where something went wrong somewhere. Even when I got to know, I could not pull my money out.
Sure.
Yeah. Whereas that doesn't happen in mutual funds.
Yeah.
So this benefit of transparency and liquidity is an awesome combo.
Yes, it is. And I think most people would see that even in short-term investments into mutual funds, not necessarily just the long-term investments. However, what we'll try to do now, viewers, that we, let's assume that the arguments of both the experts about why mutual funds are apt for investing in for retirement suit your style as well. Let's try and do two things now over the course of the next 20 odd minutes left on the show, which is try and give you some math around what kind of money would you need at the current inflation, etc., some calculators at different age buckets. And then also we'll try and tell our guests to tell us that if you want to invest into funds, what's the ideal allocation within the different mutual fund buckets that are available, how much of equity, how much of debt at different age groups. Now, a calculator that was shared with us, or a math or a table that was shared with us, spoke about how retirement planning at current age at different age brackets.
Right.
You want to start off with that? Either of you can start off with that.
Yeah, so essentially, the earlier you start, as Gaurav was mentioning, the benefit of compounding works wonders. So even if you start with a reasonably smaller amount, that can grow to a good sum at the time of retirement. Having said that, the estimation of retirement amount may be done in some shape and form, that how much money would be required at the time of retirement. And there, so first of all, let's look at the situation of different people. Somebody may have accumulated in some other form or shape. It could be a retirement benefit coming from the job. There could be some sort of retirement income in form of pension. So these are the possibilities. Then look at how much annually you are likely to spend in the retirement years. And based on that, the corpus can be estimated. Then work backwards.
Okay.
Now, working backwards would mean that I'll start an SIP, and if I'm able to increase my SIP amount year after year, it's a reasonable to assume that people would have growing salaries. Again, it's an assumption.
Safe assumption.
But safe
usually
assumption,
it would work
safe
that
assumption.
Way.
Yes. And tweaking can be done along the way by reviewing. And then look at the numbers. So let's say if you're looking at roughly 6 lakhs worth of annual expenses and putting some number to inflation around 5% or so, the retirement corpus that may be required could be something like around 6 crores or so, roughly. And in order to reach there, how much you need to invest. So somebody would say, let me look at a fixed amount, and if I keep that amount fixed all throughout the period, roughly 50,000 would be the monthly SIP amount, which looks huge. But if you're able to grow that SIP amount year after year at around 5% a year, then roughly 32,000, 33,000 could be the starting amount. And then you keep growing it.
Can I just interject here? I just wanted some explanation, because a lot of viewers would understand. On this current plate itself, when we're saying the current age is 35, 45, and 50 years, why is the corpus which is needed at retirement differing significantly? Wouldn't the corpus that I need at a particular age of 60, whatever my age currently is, be the same? I'm just trying to understand that.
So the way the table was made is starting at the current expense level. And then you estimated inflation.
Okay.
Because you're already at 50. 50 to 60, the expenses will not grow significantly.
Okay.
Whereas from 35 to 60, the expenses would grow significantly. So one could have looked at different numbers, because somebody at 35, the annual expenses are likely to be less than somebody at 50.
So because medication expenses, etc.
We could have looked at different numbers.
Sure.
But the way we started was a particular number, whatever the age. So that's the expense. And then did the calculation. That's why, for somebody starting at 50, the corpus required is lower in this calculation. But on the other end, the time available is also shorter for that person to save. And because of that, the amount required to be saved goes up.
So Neeraj, if you look at the table, while the corpuses are different, even the amount needed. So in so many instances, the amount needed per month is significantly lower, even though the corpus needed is more.
It is more.
Sure.
So that's where the entire issue comes up, that yes, lesser the years, my corpus needed is less, but I need to save. So here on the screen, at 50 years required 2.5 crores, but what you need to save per month is 1,04,000 if it's going to grow by 5%. If you're looking at 35 years, it's 6 crores is what you need. But even if I'm saying 32,000, I'm set. So,
And I just want to give a disclaimer out here that this is ceteris paribus, that other things remaining constant and other expenses being taken care of.
Right.
There is no one size that fits all, remember viewers, but this is in an ideal case scenario, that if you take these numbers as ballpark the estimates, because some people might say, okay, annual expenses of 6 lakhs, no, I spend more than that. But that is separate. Then you can do the math accordingly. But if your expenses are 6 lakh rupees, then this table
kind
of fits.
There'll be enough calculators on Google. If somebody wants to put a retirement calculator, there'll be enough, and you can play around based on your situation and even keep reviewing it at regular intervals.
Okay.
So if we just look at the table itself, there are a lot of assumptions in on the table. The rate of return is an assumption.
Yes.
Inflation is an assumption. Number of years to be spent in retirement is an assumption. And retirement age is also an assumption.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it will be different for different people, of course. Yeah.
It would be. And therefore, the math can be done accordingly. But this is an ideal case scenario. In a typical scenario, you start at 30, you end at 60, you work for 30 years, and then you live for another 25-30 years, and this is the expected rate of inflation, so on and so forth. Now, my question then, therefore, that comes in is that let's work with an assumption that these numbers stand the test of time. How do we segregate what an individual investor should do. We know the amounts. The individual investor at 30, 45 or closer to retirement knows the amounts.
Yeah.
30, 45 and 50. Yeah. Let's assume those are the three numbers. Let's assume the viewer or the investor, he or she, is convinced that he or she will save through mutual funds.
Yeah.
How does he segregate what kind of funds that he saves money into at these different age brackets? Is there an ideal scenario out
here? So here it is, simple principle. At 35, you have more than 20, 25 years. And hence, equity is the best asset class. So pick up an equity-based mutual fund. Even at 45, if you're looking at 60 as a retirement age, you have almost 15 years. At 50 also you have a decade, but if at 35 I can do mid and small cap, at 50 I may want to do only a large cap or an index fund. So then you may want to modify the kind of equity fund that is there. Now if there was an example of 5 years, I would have said either go for a blended debt and equity fund or a pure debt fund, because the number of years are less. So depending on how many years are left, you should be able to decide the asset class, and even within that asset class, choose the category of fund.
Okay. The table that we have right now is something that Amit Trivedi sent us. So before I get to Amit, Gaurav, just wondering, look at these numbers on your screen. For age groups in 30s, 40s and 50s, this is a segregation that Amit gave. You can differ, by the way, but is this an ideal breakup that you would do, or would you tweak it a bit? And then we'll get to Amit about why does he believe this is an ideal thing for him.
So I would tweak it a little bit, because by nature, a little bit more aggressive. So I would say in 30s, if you're anyway contributing towards PPF and EPF, which is taking care of your debt, then don't do a debt fund.
Okay.
Put it in directly, or you may have to anyway do a debt fund for your other goals in terms of housing or whatever. So in case there are real bad times, then move it. But that's just by nature, I'm a little more aggressive, as in saying that in your earlier years, if there is a employee provident fund, public provident fund, now if there is an NPS, and then you need to take a call whether where is that money going. So retirement as a corpus, and within that corpus asset allocation, the need would and the approach would change from an advisor to advisor, but Neeraj, it won't be significantly different. So if you go from one doctor to another, somebody will say take it thrice a day of medicine. Somebody would say do twice a day and 5 mg or 10 mg. But for example, if Amit has done 80-20, I may do 90-10. But the 80-20, 80 equity and 10 debt or whatever it is, 20 debt, will not go to 20 equity and 80 debt. Utna difference nahi hoga.
Itna difference nahi hoga. Okay, and by the way, there are a bunch of queries that we have even on the live show, so we'll try and ask our experts some of those. But if we can just go back to the table, because this was the ideal split that Amit gave. Now Amit, come in on this. Gaurav is saying that he's a bit more aggressive, therefore he will remove debt. What is your rationale of why investors should follow this kind of split between the different fund categories?
So while sending this table to you, I had initially written a line that this is for more suited for a conservative person.
Okay.
Again, which is my type of a profile, and which is very similar to what Gaurav also mentioned. But at the same time, in this allocation, I'm not considering the other savings that somebody has done. So I'm assuming that this is entirely a retirement portfolio.
Okay, so a person doesn't have PPF, doesn't have NPS, etc.
So now if you start adding that, then what Gaurav was mentioning in this would come in line. However, I would like to just clarify one more thing out here is, if you see from 30s to 40s to 50s, the allocation to equity keeps reducing and debt and liquid is going up. Now, this can be achieved in two ways. Either you periodically shift some money from equity to debt as you go closer to the retirement age, or if you're doing an SIP, your initial SIPs could be tilted more towards equity, and in the later years, your SIPs could be tilted largely towards liquid and debt, so that automatically that rebalancing happens.
Okay.
Third, whenever we look at retirement as a goal, the retirement age is only a date when the financial situation changes, but the need for money actually starts, the withdrawal starts from the month after retirement, and it has to continue till one survives. So to that extent, it's an immediate term, short term, medium term, and long term need. And that's where the planning, so even for a retired person, though I'm a conservative investor, I would say allocation to equity is necessary, simply because one has to survive, or rather at least plan for those long years.
Yeah, because I think viewers also keep in mind that, again, I may be wrong here, but the typical household inflation is very much unlike the inflation numbers that we have. It's not 5%. You go and buy broccoli, cheese and wine, that your inflation is not 5%. It is northwards of maybe 8-10% or thereabouts, and therefore maybe an all debt portfolio might actually be destructive for your wealth after retirement, because the expenses are continuous, but your earnings are only coming in through this portfolio. So you got to keep that
so
at the back of your mind.
So when it comes to inflation,
yes,
all of us individually love to outperform the government.
Oh yes, and we managed to do that very easily. Very easily. Okay, there are some questions that have come in, and I just want to take a few. I mean, you know, of course, there's somebody saying that please talk about early retirement as well. What if I don't want to work till 60 and what I want to work only till 45? Can I tweak these goals a little
yes,
bit?
Yes, you can. You don't take.
Yeah, please.
So then there are two things you must keep in mind, and I'm telling you from the planner's perspective, where we have handled these clients. Two important things is, one is you need to have an extremely simple lifestyle, because you're going to have lesser number of years to accumulate corpus. Second is you need to continue living that simple lifestyle, because your corpus has to last much longer. So then early retirement is when you are already at a stage where you're saying, I'm not a slave of lifestyle. Yeah. There are a lot of other things that I want to do. So we are looking more at a life planning kind of situation. So when you mentioned my book, that's what I mentioned about. It's overall life planning that we are talking about. And hence we are talking a completely different paradigm.
Okay.
As in, then you want to pursue a hobby, you want to pursue an occupation, there are a lot of other things, and hence lifestyle is not of importance. If somebody wants to say that I want to retire early and maintain the lifestyle, then probably find out somebody who will give you huge corpus.
Yeah, I think both the points. Sorry, Amit, do you want to add to that?
So in fact, the corollary to the same argument is that it's easier to find a second job at 45 or 50, but impossible to find one at 75. So if you run out of money by 70, 75 years of age, what do you do in that case?
Precisely.
So it's better to continue working. Even if you want to retire, do some part-time freelance job and let the inflow continue. Don't stop it. Unless you got a huge corpus already built in, and your lifestyle is moderate or very simple,
but
then it's okay.
Yeah, in which case you anyways know that your income is outstripping your expenses, so you're fine. But if you don't have that, then there is an issue. Okay, somebody is asking that is somebody with an age 30 earning about 35,000 rupees per month and monthly expenses of about 20,000. So let's assume that 70% of the income goes in expenses monthly, and whether then is NPS a good option, or should that person stick largely to mutual funds, because perceptibly the returns in mutual funds over a long period of time would be higher. Is there an answer that you have?
I don't know. I would then say either split between NPS and mutual fund, not only because of tax benefit. NPS, we are still new. We don't have a long performance history, but they are significantly lower in terms of expenses. And there is a great possibility that over a period of time, they may generate higher returns purely because the expenses are less. On the other hand, I'm not too sure, Amit, correct me, but if there is an option to go 100% on equity at 30, 35, you may want to go here.
Right.
My feeling is 50 is maximum, but if you're putting it on automatic or something, then you have option to go up to 75. So you have to keep these factors in mind, but purely looking at the expenses, because NPS has fairly less expenses, though in terms of liquidity, mutual funds are a much better option. NPS,
yes,
they've kept adding different asset classes, but it's still not as much versatile as mutual fund is. You may want to split across the board.
So I would just like to add in this case of NPS is that NPS is still, as Gaurav was mentioning, it's a relatively new vehicle. And in spite of that, there has been a lot of tweaking which has already happened. So in order to understand that vehicle properly, we'll need some more time as to what to expect out of it. And because you are not allowed to take 100% equity as of now, that could be one of the reasons. So if you are okay with a split between equity and debt, fair enough. But dividing money between mutual fund and NPS, it's like a known devil and a lesser known devil.
In fact, government themselves are not showing. Sorry to say on show, but yeah, I firmly believe. So, viewers, these are my personal opinion and not of the channel, but government themselves are not clear. They keep tweaking tax benefits and the product features and everything every now and then. So, the stability in the instrument has yet not come in.
Yeah, you got to keep that at the back of your mind. I think there's a question that has come in, and I think I can safely take that as well. Gaurav Mehrotra is asking, I've been aggressive on the pharma fund. Can it be assumed for retirement planning, a sectoral investment? Gaurav Mehrotra, I don't know if expert, just the thought, I mean, from whatever little I've learned, a sectoral fund should be taken if you are extremely knowledgeable about the sector, and that's a thematic fund that may not last necessarily for 20, 30 years. So for retirement planning, for a really long period of time, a sectoral fund may not be the best idea.
I would recommend sectorial for anything.
Any fund, right? Any sectoral fund.
Any sectorial fund, at best, I mean, you have your entire thing ready and maybe as an addition. So if it's a pizza, additional topping, but it can't be the base of the pizza.
Okay.
I love pizzas.
Okay, there is one more question that has come in from Mr. Piyush Pathak. And he's saying that he's I don't know if you want to take this question in this show or the next show. I'm laying out the question and maybe you guys say whether this is good for this show or the next show. He's saying that he's retiring after 3.5 years. And at that time, we'll have sufficient corpus in fixed avenues with medical cover. He'll contribute in the same ratio after his retirement via STP of 3 years. Is that ratio a good enough ratio? Should we take this in the next show?
No, so if he's saying I'll contribute in the same ratio after, so what he'll do after retirement, we have no idea. As far as current is concerned, he's fine. As in if he's contributing and if he's transferring funds, it's just that does he have an SIP? Because the retirement corpus will come in his hand at the time of retirement. So there's no question of STP now. But yeah, after retirement, I think we'll take it in the next show.
Okay, so post-retirement planning happens in the next show. Viewers, remember, this was the first part of this two-part mini-series of sorts that we wanted to do. One, this is for retirement only, but it is from a perspective of people who are still earning and therefore are planning for those 30 years. Next Wednesday, we'll get you, our same guests, to talk about what you should do if you have already retired and you want to maintain the lifestyle, maybe maintain the kind of earnings at the given inflationary assumptions, and how do you plan for those years of your life wherein your income has stopped but your expenses have only begun their career now. So that's an important thing as well. But for this show and for enlightening our viewers and me as well, because I'm planning for my retirement too, thank you so much for joining in, Amit, as well as Gaurav. But we'll of course see you in the next show as well when we talk about the following topic.
Thanks a lot.
A lot.
And viewers, thanks for tuning in to this leg of the Mutual Fund Show. Stay tuned to Bloomberg Quint.